And we're back.
Okay. So I wrote preparedness and consideration, not considerateness. Although rule one does say always treat each other respectfully. So the thing that I want you guys to talk about now is, so we've talked about impacts and vulnerabilities. We've talked about what related to those things we can control and what are some things we can't control. So what I'd like you to do now is, in the context of your particular organization, field of work, specialty, things you do, you can think about it, Becky, from either from the business real estate standpoint or the habitat standpoint, or both, that's cool too. From that particular standpoint, what are some things that your organization does, your group does or ought to do to consider or prepare for drought? And as you think about that, what are the impacts or the vulnerabilities that you would be trying to address in implementing that particular piece of preparedness or that consideration? Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I'll give you a second to see what I'm talking.
Well, so far on the Habitat for Humanity,
okay.
You know, when we go to build, what we've done is like, you know, because they are a limited income. Mm-hmm. Plus, the other thing we do, and water is so expensive, what we do is let's put some rock instead of grass. Let's do some of these other things rather than have the grass. And so, you know, mm-hmm. their yards are not always the green grass, you know, because of okay. money wise. And they're fine with it. They're fine with it.
Is it just landscaping that you think about? Do you also put in like low flow toilets and shower? Like, are there internal things that you also do to make it a more? Okay. So you consider drought in your home construction and landscaping. Okay, so what's the impact that you're trying to address with that?
Well, less of the usage of less water.
Okay.
Plus, it's less money for them. It's that they have to spend, and that they can spend other places. You know, like other kids and the home. So.
Okay, so you have in mind the limited economic resources. Okay. Is there anything else of the impacts that we've talked about? Are there any other of those that you might match up with that particular
Yeah, I think without really knowing it, you're helping with their mental.
Okay.
Because they're not worried about where the money's going to come to pay the water bill. It's less worrying from there.
Okay.
Which also giving them hope, mm-hmm. giving them a home, stability.
Yeah.
Which helps.
Mm-hmm. It makes a difference.
Probably the kids. Yeah.
Okay, so you see children being particularly benefited.
Because it's the place they can call their own.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And they want to put a poster on their wall, they can put a poster on the wall.
Mm-hmm. They have their own bedroom.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Is that fair?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. What else? Who else? What other organization would you, what ought you to do? What would you be trying to do with that?
with the church, try to build networks with other nonprofits and other churches, to meet the spiritual, emotional, and physical needs that we can meet.
So you're addressing the spiritual health?
Spiritual health.
Okay.
Mental health and physical health needs.
So what else might you be addressing? If I don't know.
What else might you be addressing? Putting them in touch with various resources in the community.
Talk about?
Oh, we're always fundraising.
Sure, but if you have, if everybody has less, fewer resources coming in,
we try to.
Is networking a help with that? And is that a thing that you're trying to mitigate?
Mitigate.
Or is that incidental?
It's incidental.
Okay.
I mean, like, we do have a emergency fund that we keep on hand in case of to keep the church afloat.
Okay.
So, no, it's not necessarily in case of drought, but just in case of whatever.
Okay. Are there any other impacts that you see that?
Economics.
Yours or somebody else's?
Someone else's.
Okay. The people that you're helping. Okay.
So some economic relief, paying some bills or providing food or something.
Okay.
Maybe helping them find a job.
Okay.
So.
Okay. And so Becky gave us our bonus round. We're doing the same thing for this one. Two of the vulnerable groups or vulnerable instances that we have identified, who's especially going to benefit from this event?
Who's especially going to benefit?
Yeah.
Well, we work particularly with the elderly and the working poor.
Okay.
We're always looking out for the kids.
Okay.
We're always looking out for the kids.
Hold on. Okay.
Nonprofit organizations and churches.
Okay, so it actually benefits you and your partners. Okay.
Exactly. For providing a resource to the public, they generally respond in kind.
Mm-hmm. Anyone else that particularly benefits from that? Okay. All right. Actually, should have made note of this while we're talking about these. This is something that you do already, or something you're thinking about. Okay. So one of the other things that I wanted to make notes on is something is whether these are things you do now, or whether things that you think you should do. Okay. What else? Can be same organization, can be a different organization.
So there's a lot on there for impacts at Greenland Park. I don't know how you want to do that.
Okay, well.
You know what I mean? There's like.
Well, do you want to break it up sort of by subject area? Would that, do you think that would be helpful?
Yeah. I know I can talk more about like the educational.
Right, okay.
Programs that we do. I know we have other stuff, more habitat restoration and everything else that we put on.
Okay, well, why don't we do both of those, but let's talk about them separately.
Because there may be some overlap, but there may be some things that are kind of separate. And we may pick some of that other stuff up too in the environment and recreation group too, but it doesn't hurt to talk about it now. Also, so in terms of Gaven Park and that education component, what do you do, or what do you wish you did?
Right, we're doing a little like water quality quantity type programming.
Okay. Is that general? Is that specific to consideration of drought or drought preparedness? How is that structured?
It's more quality.
Okay.
Mainly looking at little insects, macroinvertebrates, and things like that, and then also like project wet activities, water education for tomorrow activities. So doing in-home analysis. So. The water that you use, it's a different activity along those lines. So.
Okay. So if you were to structure this program, you know, or add some stuff to make it not necessarily just about drought or strictly drought related, right, but to tailor it more towards addressing one or more impacts, what do you think? What impacts do you think you would be trying to get at?
We do the recreation aspects, water recreation.
Okay.
For sure. Probably the changes in wildlife, habitats, how they would be affected. That physical health, we usually go outside, walk around.
Right.
Mental health.
Okay. Who are your primary beneficiaries of that?
Kids, children. They're normally the ones that come to the
okay. Okay, so you want to talk about the more wildlife habitat aspect of Gaven Park? Okay. Oh, and I guess before we leave education, you said this is a thing you're sort of doing now. Is there something that
I think we need to do more on? It's not doom and doom for drought, what, you know, what we want to do.
I'm sorry, what?
What we want to do in the future. We're doing a little bit about, like, water use and things like that, but we don't do a lot about if there's a drought, that kind of thing. So there needs to be a little bit more, I guess, in-depth programming around drought.
Okay. Okay, if you were to implement that, would you be trying to get the same impacts that you already do? Would you be trying to address something that's on that list that you don't right now?
It would probably be pretty similar.
Okay.
I don't know how I can track the gas prices, but that does play a role.
Okay.
Because I know, like I said, we're 8 miles out of town, so that does affect our gas prices. We're super high. We're not getting as much attention and things like that. But there's really not a lot of offset that.
Right. Okay. Okay. Anything else under education? All right.
Now we can make it happen.
Mm-hmm. You can use your
why not?
Why well, I guess I can start using that one.
Okay, so under the habitat. What does Game and Park do now? What ought they to be doing?
I know they do some like wildfire mitigation, not mitigation, but prescribed fires, making sure that if something were to take over, okay. A little bit of that habitat, like more habitat restoration type stuff.
Okay, and what impact are they trying to get out of that?
I think part of it's the lessen the damage wildfire damage. They also want to make sure that firefighting resources they also do some training with them. I'm sure they're always looking at wildlife behaviors and habitats.
Mm-hmm.
Recreation is a big one.
That's related to this?
Mm-hmm.
How so?
Hunting recreation. It's not going to be water-based recreation.
Okay, well, that's okay.
I'm going to write that down so that at least I know what it is.
Okay.
I'm sure they're going to help. I'm sure folks they're going to help are going to be like your farmers and ranchers. It's going to be probably going to benefit most from landowners.
Okay. So our farmers, so these are primary beneficiaries, do you think? Okay. So that should actually be green. We're going to start there with that in green. Who else is benefiting from that, if anybody?
Wow.
Does that count? They're not. It does. In fact, they are on our list of vulnerable.
Are they?
Well, every ecosystem. Oh, right. Them separately.
No, I didn't know. Ecosystems.
All right. Any other vulnerable groups? The benefit
would be the firefighters.
Okay.
A resource for the civilian. And businesses and hunting and tourism type thing.
Okay. Okay. Once again, is anything? Okay. Anything else? What else? What do you do? What do you wish you did?
Well, one of the things that we're doing on the national level that affects us is that our International Orthodox Christian Charities, the national branch of it, is pulling together all of our resources so that we have an idea of what resources we have available anywhere in the country to handle a natural disaster or any type of disaster or crisis event. So that what do we have? How can we contribute? What are, you know, do we have showers in our facilities? What you know, those type of things, our physical resources that we can draw upon in case of a disaster.
Okay. Assessing those resources, or are you making a plan for how they, so is it an assessment thing? Is it a planning thing? Is it a deployment thing?
It's an assessment for in case of deployment.
Okay.
Or in case of, what was the other word you used?
Planning.
For planning.
Okay.
Yeah, planning and deployment.
Okay. Does natural disasters include drought?
Yes.
Okay. What's the scale that they do that on? Do they do that on a state level, or do they look at individual parishes? How do they?
Individual parishes.
Okay. So they actually are looking at bigger and rougher.
Yes.
Okay.
They're looking at, they start at the metropolis level or diocese level, and then they've asked every parish in our diocese to do this assessment for them so that they know what we have at the local level. Each parish has. So.
Okay. Yeah. What's their plan for this?
Their plan is that in any case that there is a national disaster or a state disaster, whatever disaster happens, that we have a disaster resource team that goes out. Employed to help in those situations.
Okay.
As well as, can we house FEMA workers? Can we house Red Cross workers? Can we house or feed volunteers, rescuers, crisis responders? That type of thing. That's the plan with different folks.
Okay.
And they've already done that in certain parts of the country, but they wanted to roll it out so we know what we can do.
Okay. Are there specific goals and objectives that the organization has formulated for this particular exercise? For example, have they, for each natural disaster that they're looking at, is there a set list of impacts or goals relative to the disaster that they're aiming at, or are they letting local the parish level people decide here's the impacts we need to address?
It would be what resources do we have available? We just state this is our facilities. Then they will determine how those facilities to be utilized. But the parish, and of course the local parish can always say, no, we don't want that.
Sure.
We can't do that.
Okay.
We always have that right. But that way they know though that let's say a drought or a fire or something happened out here. And they need to send in workers, volunteers, whatever, crisis responders. What can we do to help them out?
Okay. Do you have to wait for them to identify the need?
No.
Okay. So you can tell
them. We identify the need and tell them we need their help.
Okay. Okay. So if you were going to be identifying a need for which you would be asking them to help,
right,
what would those needs be in terms of some of the impact we talked about? What do you mm-hmm. anticipate you would be calling to help with?
Feeding, coming in, doing crisis counseling.
Okay.
Providing water.
Okay.
Providing water, definitely. Food, clothing. Those are emergency kits, hygiene mm-hmm. kits, and so forth.
Okay. Anything else?
Helping us to network better with the, like with FEMA or those organizations.
Where's primary beneficiaries?
Primary beneficiaries?
Yeah.
Are going to be the people hit hardest by the disaster.
Who's that going to be?
Depending. Well, in a drought?
Mm-hmm. That's what we're talking about.
Exactly. Well, it's going to be helping the everyone that's coming to us for a reason.
So, okay.
Be all classes of people, all the elderly, the working poor, children, those that are on the margins of society, homeless.
Mm-hmm. Well, homeless are not on our list of vulnerabilities.
I know, and they should be. We have lower socioeconomic groups, but I think we should put the homeless up there.
Okay.
But they would be.
Did I miss one that you were missing?
No. Okay. I knew there was someone who was
okay. So that is a thing that the umbrella organization is doing right now.
We're
okay.
working on towards that way.
Okay. Is there a future step that either the umbrella organization is going to take or that mm-hmm. your parish is going to take because you're going through this exercise?
Ideally, our parish will prepare a preparedness document, an emergency management or emergency preparedness document, mm-hmm. how we would go about things.
So ideally that in the sense that you're really not
going to
do it, or,
no,
or it's really going to, okay.
It's supposed to happen.
Okay.
We're supposed to do that. Yes.
Would you include drought as one of those, as one of the components of this plan?
Sure, yeah, it's something that it will affect the parishioners in this area of the local body.
Okay. Yeah. Conveniently, you're doing drought planning process right now.
So you're
even an expert by that time. So, because you're going to be an expert, when you get to that part of the plan, mm-hmm. what are some of the impacts that you think you want to include in that plan?
Mental health issues.
Okay.
Spiritual health. Then there's like this well, food resources.
Okay.
Putting pressure on the political decision making and so forth, to a degree, good influence. Make sure that the people on the margins are not left out, or the needs of being met. They aren't being forgotten.
Okay. Okay. Do you see the primary beneficiaries of this being the same as this one, or is there something that would be particular or different?
No.
Same. Okay.
I think doing what we're exactly what we're doing here.
Mm-hmm.
Starting today.
Okay, so how would you phrase that in terms of our preparedness and consideration? So
we're thinking about
preparedness. Okay. Mm-hmm.
All of our nonprofit, church groups, government agencies, and starting.
Okay, so all of your respective groups, right, by being part of this, or okay,
yeah.
Okay,
opens the door for the conversation to become larger,
essentially. Exactly.
Mm-hmm. I don't want to do an entire paper to that, so we're going to tack that on at the end. So let's see. Church. I didn't bring my blue marker. We're going to pretend this is blue. Participating. In deciding to participate in this particular process, mm-hmm, did you have any of these impacts in mind as things that you were trying to address for your organization or for yourself? Or had you even thought of that? And if there were particular impacts that you had in mind, which ones were they?
When you first called me, I think it was a little and asked me if I wanted to participate, I started thinking, well, why in the world am I going to be Dr. Ralph? I started thinking, well, it would affect these families, and then my mind started, well, you know, this is important to start thinking about.
Okay.
And how it would impact our small parish.
Okay.
And what ministries that we could provide, what resources that we could provide,
okay,
to help those who are impacted by the threat.
Okay, so were you thinking about that from a, when you say ministries, are you, mm-hmm, talking just about the spiritual health and the mental health, or are you also talking about physical circumstances?
Physical, okay, circumstances, you know, could we house people, could we,
okay,
feed people, could we provide water, provide counseling, that type of thing.
Becky, Amanda, what about you? Should I just write yes?
I don't know if I had any impacts like in mind. I just know that there were some things that we were doing, like the classes that were having, you know, a direct impact, but wanted to expand our reach a little bit more. To reach more than just little class.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Most of it's probably going to be physical health, getting out and experiencing all that fun stuff.
Okay.
Mental health too, I suppose.
Okay. What about with you, Becky?
Yeah, with the hemp pit, we have a studio. We were thinking about probably the last 10, 11 builds on, you know, doing stuff that because, the water in almost every community, the price of water has gone up quite a bit. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we have to be mindful of how we're going to pay the payment and how we're going to pay the utilities and things like that. So we have to be really mindful on some of those things while we're doing this.
Okay.
Do you have other things that you would add if you were to consider the perspective of a small business? If you're speaking about Habitat for Humanity and your interaction with them, but if you consider your work as a realtor or even other local businesses, small businesses, are there things that we need to add? Our business sector was so small that we convinced you all into other groups, and so I'm afraid that those perspectives are going to start to get missed if all of our other groups don't also consider them. So I don't know if there's gaps that you feel might be in here. If you were a small business owner, what types of things might you do now? What types of things maybe could business consider?
You know, like the restaurants, they're, when you went into a restaurant, most times you know, you brought you water. Yeah. Now they ask you if you want water before they serve you it, because they're not going to give it to you if it's going to stay there and they're going to throw it out. So you have to ask for that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, some that, and I know like landlords, they put in that, because we have some rentals, we put in the low water for the toilets. So we do some of that so that, you know, it helps the renter.
Mm-hmm. Out. How widespread is that? How many landlords would you say? I mean, just ballpark. Think about that sort of thing.
I would say probably 50% of them.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Anything else we want to add to that collection?
I don't know what they're doing in the schools now. I don't want to speak for education department or issue 13, but I wonder if we need to explore that aspect too, because I don't know what's being taught in each classroom or anything like that when it comes to drought.
Conveniently, we're about to segue to the topic of
okay.
Good job. I was trying to make sure we were done with that one first. So, these are some things you're doing now. We talked a little bit about some things you'd like to be doing or intend to be doing in the future. One of the other things that came out a lot, in particularly under what we can control, was the topic of education and knowledge. Also, this is the group that involves educators. Even though we're not just that. So clearly education is pretty important, at least to you, because it came up a lot. So, even though we don't know what's being done right now, we'll sort of put aside whatever already exists and we'll construct what we think could exist. So in thinking about preparedness, consideration, the impacts and vulnerabilities that we talked about today, what do you think people need to know? And you can answer this from perspective of your organization. What do you need to know about drought, about any of these things that we've talked about? What do you think that people outside your organization need to know? And how do you think those things are best delivered?
I guess starting with like the basics, what is drought? How does it affect you? You know, okay. Starting with the beginning is for some people that might not know the history that is in this area with drought.
Okay.
Or something like that.
Is that something that your organization needs, or is that something that you perceive as a need outside of your organization?
Outside of my organization.
Okay.
My
organization.
But no, outside of my
okay.
my organization.
So let's say basics of drought, and you said the local history.
History or just what is drought? How does it, you know, affect you type of a
okay.
I think you have to teach kids early on where the water comes from.
Okay, so that's backing it out. It's sort of a step further back.
They turn on the faucet, that's all they know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Okay.
What is the sump pump water?
Yeah.
Where does it come from?
So, do you think that it's only children that need to know that?
No, I think a lot of city people need to know
okay.
that. Mm-hmm. The local people need to know that.
Okay. Is that something that your organization needs? Or is it just people outside of your organization?
I think the organizations and people outside the organization.
I think both.
Yep. Yeah, you too.
Emergency preparedness.
Right. Inside, outside, or both?
Both.
Okay.
And what you can do on an everyday basis to conserve water.
Okay, so.
I mean, don't throw one thing in the washing machine just because you want to wear it.
Right. Well, I think that would also tie into like the plants, habitats, mm-hmm. that ties into the less grass type mm-hmm. stuff to water, just that everyday conservation practice.
Okay. Inside, outside, or both?
I
Are these all things? So like this one, I specifically asked if it was just kids or if it was people of all ages. Is that true of all of these things? Are there some of them that make more sense for adults versus children? What do you think?
I don't know if kids really need to know emergency preparedness, but if they're from the older ones to know, but
family preparedness.
Right.
How, what to do in regards to drought, I don't know what kids can do. But yeah, I mean, make sure you have water, employees for food supply. I think it'd be important for kids to know those things.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so you do see that there is a component that could be taken.
Component could be,
okay.
You know, set up at their development level.
Oh, sure. What about these other two?
Yeah.
All ages? Yeah.
I think so.
What else? What else do you need to know? What do you need to know?
I'd say community leaders. I think it's important that community leaders know each other.
Okay.
And how to collaborate in the case of a drought situation.
Okay. You see that as being, as knowing how to collaborate. Is that something that is a formal educational process? Is that something that you see just that people need to know that's a possibility and that's all?
No. I think a plan should be put in place.
Okay.
So that everyone knows what each, but not necessarily responsibilities, but resources that are out there that can be drawn upon. Habitat for Humanity has this, and I'm like, hey, I can send someone over to Becky and have them deal with whatever Habitat for Humanity can supply.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So, send them up to the Wildcats and go for a walk. Right. Look at the one nice one there.
So, we want to educate people about who the local community leaders are. That includes educating the local
community leaders
about each other.
Yeah.
And so then how do you want to phrase that networking or that collaboration part?
For collaboration.
Okay.
And knowledge of resources, area local resources.
Okay. Who's the age group?
Adults.
Okay. Inside, outside, or both? Who needs to know that?
On the outside.
Okay. What?
the Ogallala Aquifer. I know we talked about where water comes from. Does that fit in there, especially in western Nebraska?
Well, I guess it depends on how far back you want to back out your picture when you're talking about where water comes from. Mm-hmm. You know, if it's so, for example, Becky used the example of kids in the city just running on the tap. Do you want to just back it up to the city well field? Do you want to talk about where the water in those wells come from? You know, how big of a hydroelectric system do you want to do? So, yeah, you could do it in a fairly small sort of microcosm sense, or you could talk about things like aquifers.
I think it'd be important.
Mm-hmm.
So that the kids know how important aquifers are,
mm-hmm.
so that they are protected.
Okay.
So they protect that aquifer
yeah.
all the time, so they grow up.
Yeah.
With the, you know,
respect for it, mm-hmm. and yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Anti-pollution,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
proper farming techniques, and so forth. You know, poison ground.
Yeah, so that they ever become a politician, they understand. Water.
That we don't stick the pipelines in water. I'm sorry, I'm getting off on number six.
I was going to say in a few words. We
don't stick the pipelines in water.
Okay. So in thinking about making a drought plan, I want to look at this list, actually all of the lists that we've made here, and see if we can't highlight maybe a couple of the top things that we should think about as we're moving forward. Not that the other ones are not important,
right.
but if we had to hone in on just a handful of things, what do you see, you know, from your perspective, are the most important ones? Let me go ahead and start with education, because mm-hmm. that's where we are right now. So is it important to have an education component in the plan? If yes, what are the things that should specifically be called out? And who do you see, remember this is a community plan, who do you see as being, or who ought to be in charge of that or responsible for that? And it really in charge of that is the wrong thing to say. Who or what organization do you think, organizations, are the best ones to be part of that effort? Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So like if it's in the schools, are you thinking ESU 13 or the Department of Ed? Are we going?
Yeah, sure.
Well, those would be the two that would implement it at least.
Okay.
Or Department of Ed for sure, if it's considered a state standard in the hands of teacher.
Okay.
ESU,
sure, what if it isn't?
Yeah, then we have our power to go to our governors or whatever local.
Talk to the,
you're right.
The school boards and stuff.
Okay. So let's start small. Should there be an education component in a community drought plan? Yeah, you're right.
If we say no, can we go home?
No, we still have to do a couple of these other. Sorry. And we've only got 10 minutes left. It's not going to make that much of a difference.
I would say yes.
Okay. All right.
At least a small.
Yes.
A small
something.
Yeah.
Some kind of, okay.
Mm-hmm.
So what are the things that a drought plan should focus on in terms of education?
I would think that you would like to have some explanation of what a drought is,
okay.
its effects, history, a small
okay.
Section about that. So people, why are we dealing with this?
Mm-hmm.
Oh. Like the where your water comes from, so you
okay.
get a basic need, where your water, what it is, how to take care of it. conservation practices. So we know what it is, we know where it comes from, and we know what we can do to help.
If the drought plan is for the local area, then some breakdown of how the local leaders can collaborate. Very helpful.
Heck, why we got it up there, we might as well just.
Well, I was just gonna say,
So we need to be, what is emergency preparedness? How do you prepare for that?
You want all the things. All right.
One.
Just one more. So, in looking at our list of impacts and vulnerabilities, and in thinking about what are the things we can control versus what are the things we cannot control. If you had to pick, let's say, your top five impacts and your top three vulnerable groups, those are completely arbitrary numbers, by the way, what would they be?
And say kids is on almost all of our lists over there.
Vulnerabilities.
Yeah. Oh, your primary
boundaries? Yeah, so I think one of our groups that we're gonna reach would probably have to be children.
Okay. Children's one. We're not gonna write anything down until we agree on the three and the five.
It's important for either the working poor or the lower socioeconomic groups.
Okay.
How do you want to label that?
Well, they're sort of intertwined.
Lower socioeconomic group is a larger umbrella.
It is. So do you want the smaller?
I would prefer the larger.
Do you want the bigger one? Okay, so.
Yeah.
Do we have consensus on this? Okay. Children, lower socioeconomic groups. Who's number three? Who's your third?
Are we talking just for like our education or this group here? Because I mean, you go back and forth between like the farmers and ranchers or the ecosystems and habitats.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Some of those are pretty big ones, or your nonprofit and church organizations.
Well, I'm kind of asking that from your sort of professional or education hat perspective. But it's also unreasonable for me to tell you to turn off everything else, so. But when we were identifying the primary beneficiaries before, you did have your education hat on, so.
So your farmers and ranchers would be a little vulnerable.
Is that what you want for your third?
Go for it.
I think I would agree with that.
Do you have a particular order of consideration? In other words, are children the most important? Are the lower socioeconomic groups most important? Does it matter? Because I'm going to put numbers if you think it matters. If it doesn't, I'm just going to put it over.
Doesn't matter to you. It doesn't matter to me.
Okay. No, we're all pretty sure. Okay, top five impact. If you were going to make a plan, but you could only focus on, or you wanted your plan to focus on five impacts, what are the five that you should definitely focus on?
I would say the economic situation.
Mm-hmm. Mental health.
Okay. We have economics and mental health.
Physical health.
Physical health.
Demand for social services.
Demand for social services, okay. Becky, what do you think?
I would say your wildfire damage and your wildlife behavior is kind of, you know, if you're going to have wildfire damage, you're going to, your behavior and your wildlife is going to be a little bit, I don't know.
that's true. They are connected.
And you know, we got so many wildfires going now. I mean, mm-hmm. The one by Llewellyn.
So I'm like, well,
yeah.
Wow.
They got about eight houses.
Oh my gosh.
By lake.
Mm-hmm. By
wow.
Lake, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we actually have, because they're listed separately, we have six things on the table now. We have economic situation, mental health, physical health, demand on social services, wildfire damage, and change in wildlife behavior, change in wildlife behavior and habitat. That's six. And I said five. Can we come to a consensus on which ones are what?
Can we both combine the health?
That's called mental health.
Right.
I'd be open.
Okay, so instead of thinking of these as separate and unrelated, you want to combine them so that it's one impact with sort of a lot of,
right? So it's a person, yeah.
Okay.
It affects the person as a whole, whether it be.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So. Bring that down there and make that one category.
Yep.
Now one spot. Same question with this. Do you have a priority in mind of which ones are most versus least important, or are they equally important? Do you have a ranking in your head?
Sort of. I can see the physical and mental health being possibly number one.
Okay.
I don't know about the rest of them, but like I said, that one was mentioned quite a bit
okay.
on all everybody's list today.
Okay.
I agree.
Okay. Becky, do you agree? Okay.
I'd say economic situation number two.
Number two, okay.
But yes.
Mm-hmm.
And that's another factor.
So that leads us increased demand on social services, wildfire damage, and wildlife habitat. Do those have a priority? Do any of those have a priority to follow this one?
Well, I think the physical mental health would definitely have a huge impact on the demand for social services. Or fire and habitat.
Okay.
So those don't really have a particular place in the priority line. Is this three? Okay. So you do think this should be three or?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So we had talked before about the briefly about the planning group. The idea is rather than have all 40 of you be sitting in a room trying to write a drought plan at the same time, what we were thinking of is having each sector group, so like this is you guys a sector group, would pick one or two representatives who would be part of that process. Everybody will still be in the loop of what's going on with that, but not all of you would have to go to the planning meeting parts that are part of the June schedule. So one of the things you don't have to do is now, but sometime between now and June, be thinking about who in your group, obviously everybody's not here, who in your group ought to be or wants to be that representative. I think we'll probably take two representatives from each group.
Especially with this group, maybe they're pretty diverse.
Yeah.
We have education and food, mm-hmm. and so it might be.
So, so be thinking about that. That's what that meant. It wasn't meant to be super cryptic. So, yeah, the next meeting that we'll have is the next big group meeting where everybody is going to talk about. From your organizational perspective, what are your capabilities, what are your limitations? You know, what can you just not do, either in the context of drought or administratively or whatever? Mm-hmm. So that's kind of going to help set boundaries and expectations for the kinds of things that particular people or groups can commit to in a plan, because we need to be thinking about that as we're drafting strategies. You know, everybody needs to be clear on what everybody can really do. So that's what that next meeting is going to be about. And we'll send out a little bit more information on that before the meeting so that if there is something you particularly want to make sure gets said in that conversation, you've got time to think about that. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Any questions? I feel like this was a pretty good discussion. What do you guys think?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Okay. And the last sort of follow-up, do you feel like this is a pretty complete discussion? Do you feel like there's stuff we didn't talk about that you definitely wanted to talk about? Did we pretty much run the gamut from the your sector perspective?
The only thing would be like the formal education folks, you know, okay. Like the schools and things like that.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
What they do in the class, but wondering what their thoughts are on some of
it. And there is one in this group? Yes?
Marie was.
Right.
And Dustin.
And Dustin, mm-hmm. right. So we got one, and she left before we got to that part of the conversation. Right.
That would be very helpful.
Okay. Is that something that you feel like we definitely need to talk about before we move to that next phase? Such that, like, we would need to have another meeting? Is that something that you want to hear in that next big group meeting where we're talking about organizational capabilities? What do you think?
Are you planning to send these notes out to yeah. the small groups? Mm-hmm. Would there be the opportunity for them to say, mm-hmm. hey, you know?
Sure, one thing that we can do when we send that out, because you're going to have comment capabilities on the Google Docs mm-hmm. thing that I will send out. So what I can do is specifically tell the formal education people, please insert your comments on this, you know, particularly in mm-hmm. this education section of the notes. Would that be sufficient, do you think? Okay.
Just to open it up so that way there's not the process to go through a whole other meeting. But if they have something they feel strongly about, they're able to at least input their...
I okay. think, yeah, because those two are gone, we also missed, you know, schools as institutions, so right. not only what's taught in the mm-hmm. classrooms, but also how are they going to sustain themselves as, mm-hmm. I mean, we mentioned the lower taxes and whatnot, we never got to yeah, how that could trickle down and affect the whole.
Sure.
Yeah.
And two, they may also have some things that they want to add to that preparedness list, yeah. too. So, okay, so I will make sure when I send out the link to share that I call attention to that. Specifically for those people, please add your feedback to these sessions. All right. Thank you, everybody. You are free to go.
In case you're still wondering why we're doing this.